AAPI, I think it's the 38th annual convention. I think the whole world is getting used to this new format with the connecting via the internet and computers, et cetera, and we're all adapting well. And we are gonna get started on a topic that is relevant to my field of neurosurgery. I'm a neurosurgeon in Chicago, Illinois, and one illness that is a significant portion of my practice is intracerebral hemorrhage. Intracerebral hemorrhage is a devastating illness. It has plagued the neurosurgical profession for many decades, and there have been some advances. Although small, they are advances in the management of this very morbid condition. So I'll be talking about that. You can see the topic is the conversion of an ICH nihilist, and that would be referring to me and many neurosurgical trainees. As we manage these patients in our hospitals, they have a very devastating illness, and you see them long term, and even the survivors have significant disability, and it can be very defeating. As physicians, we want to restore neurological function, not only save life, and this is an illness that presents very many obstacles in accomplishing that goal. But we'll go through this. It's a talk that should fill up the 45-minute time slot and allow time for a nice discussion afterwards as well. Here are my disclosures. There are many devices used with the management of intracerebral hemorrhage. I have no consulting or financial agreements with these companies, nor will I be endorsing the use of any of these products, but they do come up in the talk as they must, so that this is my disclosure. The brief overview of what we'll be talking about, we'll go over some basic intracerebral hemorrhage background statistics. We'll talk about medical therapy, largely the futility of medical therapy, and then we'll talk about surgical approaches and kind of how I foresee the field having success with managing this condition. So the incidence of strokes, if I would have known this would be such a global talk, I would have put up more global statistics. These are United States statistics extrapolated from data taken in 1999 up through 2020. And you'll see mentioned much in this in the data. There's roughly 740,000 strokes per year. If you extrapolate that with population growth, the United States is specifically approaching about 1 million strokes. Now that's not all hemorrhages, those are mostly ischemic strokes. But if you do the same thing and you extrapolate intracerebral hemorrhages, you will have approximately 100,000 in the United States per year in the modern era. So it is a not uncommon form of stroke, and it is quite morbid, as you'll see in a minute. What are we talking about with hemorrhages? They are not all the same. They have different etiologies. This is a Finnish classification system that basically looks at different etiologies of intracerebral hemorrhage with a catchy acronym. SMASH-U, and you can see that if you take the three big players here, which are hypertensive hemorrhages, amyloid angiopathy, and medications, namely anticoagulants, those make up about 70% of all hemorrhages that are dealt with. And as you can also see here, as they group these into outcome, you can see that the hypertensive hemorrhages specifically, as well as the structural hemorrhages do quite well. The hypertensive hemorrhages are kind of in between on their outcomes, and the medically related hemorrhages are those with systemic etiologies, such as metastatic cancer, do the poorest. Another classification out of Spain, again with a catchy acronym, H-Atomic, similarly divides these into different categories, and you can see again the three big players here. The three main causes of intracerebral hemorrhage are hypertension, anticoagulant medications, and cerebral amyloid angiopathy. So who is affected by this pathology? This is a large meta-analysis looking at 36 different series, and you can see that the incidence of intracerebral hemorrhage goes up dramatically after age 65. The average incidence is about 25 per 100,000 person years, and you can see it soars to well over 100 as patients get into their 70s. And why would this happen? Well, the three main causes we talked about, hypertension, anticoagulants, and cerebral amyloid angiopathy, are mostly endemic in septuagenarians and octogenarians. So that does tie together nicely. Outcome after intracerebral hemorrhage is not good, as I alluded to in the opening of the presentation. The 30-day mortality is the worst of all stroke subtypes. It's about 45% 30-day mortality. And that mortality does continue as time goes on. You can see going out on this graph out to 5 years, only about 30% of people are surviving at 5 years. Functional outcome, just as important as survival, only about 12 to 39% of patients are able to maintain an independent lifestyle. So it's a very morbid and a very fatal condition. And this has been known. So what predicts how someone's going to do after an intracerebral hemorrhage, specifically a supratentorial or involving the cerebrum? There are a few factors. None of these are very surprising. Age, advanced age portends a worse outcome as it does with almost any other medical condition. The severity of the stroke and the volume of the intracerebral hemorrhage. And these can be used to very reliably predict outcome. Also, the presence of intraventricular hemorrhage, which is bleeding into the portions of the intracranial cavity that have spinal fluid, also creates a very complicating factor. And also the function of the patient prior to the stroke are things that have been shown to affect outcome. Interestingly, it's not necessarily, even though I've been saying repeatedly, intracerebral hemorrhage has poor outcome compared to ischemic stroke. If you standardize ischemic strokes that have a poor neurological exam to hemorrhagic strokes that have a poor neurological exam, they actually will do the same. It just happens that intracerebral hemorrhage typically present with a poor neurological exam compared to ischemic strokes. So it's not necessarily the stroke type, but how severe and how devastating the stroke is when the patient arrives to the hospital. And that's been shown pretty well in the literature. These are obviously post-mortem pictures of brains, coronal sectioning after intracerebral hemorrhage. And we don't have to be much of a pathologist to see from these examples why this illness is so devastating. So many of the white matter tracts that connect the eloquent parts of our brain are permanently disrupted. You also can have bleeding that goes into the ventricular system, which you can see from the middle slide. And this is why this is such a devastating illness. It's also very heterogeneous. So these are CAT scans from different patients with intracerebral hemorrhage. The white representing the blood within the brain parenchyma. And you can see really no two slides look alike. And this is just kind of a spattering of different scans. But you can see they're different shape, different morphology, different size, different locations. And especially for as a surgeon and how to approach these, and this is kind of how I'll end the talk as a bit of a prelude, you can see that they are very different in how you would potentially approach them. So what's the mechanisms? And I kind of talked about this with the post-mortem exams. But if we start with the upper left quadrant, primary injury. So this occurs right when the hemorrhage happens. And much of this cannot be avoided, nor can it be repaired, because this is irreparable damage to white matter tracts, typically white matter tracts within the brain. So that's the primary injury. Second to that, you have a hematoma that's pushing on white matter tracts or other portions of the brain and causing ischemia to it. So they're not damaged, but they do have mechanical pressure applied to them. So that's local mass effect. Also, there are many things that happen as the blood breaks down. There are blood breakdown products, glutamate, oxygen, free radicals, etc., that will cause secondary injury. So this is a potential avenue for improving outcomes is removing the blood and removing these free radicals, etc. And lastly, if the hematoma is large enough, one portion of the brain can shift into another portion of the compartment within the brain, and that's called herniation or herniation event. So these are all the mechanisms by which an intracerebral hemorrhage can cause injury, neurological injury specifically. So how do we treat these? So we'll start with medical therapy or best medical therapy, as is commonly known. The coagulopathy correction, which I will not dive into heavily during this talk, but with all the new anticoagulants that are coming on the market, it seems like every year there is a new agent for patients with atrial fibrillation and DVTs, et cetera. There are new agents to correct those. So there are that's the mainstay of medical therapy, especially with patients who have hemorrhages due to anticoagulation, is reversing or correcting the anticoagulation. Outside of that, hyperosmolar therapy is commonly done, blood pressure correction, and there's a slew of other agents. I've listed a few on this slide, including factor 7 and iron chelators, et cetera. So this is a study out of India. It is a randomized trial looking at hyperosmolar therapy in the setting of intracerebral hemorrhage. Specifically, they use mannitol, and they give a low dose of mannitol every 4 hours and they taper it off. It's a fairly well-designed trial. I think the treatment is one that's well thought out. I think that's a common way that hyperosmolar therapy is applied to patients with intracerebral hemorrhage. It is a small trial, but I think the patient population is one that we see. I mean, many deep hemorrhages that are difficult to manage, many of these patients had what we call shift or midline shift, and it did not show improvement in outcome. You can see the death within 7 days or death without outside of 7 days, and brain herniation was essentially identical in this trial of 128 patients. Also, another microphone here. Also, medical therapy, so blood pressure control. This is published in the New England Journal of Medicine. A very large trial, 2,400 patients almost were randomized to this. And basically, it's keeping patients' blood pressure less than 180 systolic or less than 140. So two different goals, and they randomized these patients. Relatively small hemorrhages. These hemorrhages were only 11 milliliters in size, and the growth decrease with the aggressive therapy wasn't very impressive, frankly. 1.4 milliliters decreased growth if you aggressively drop somebody's blood pressure who has an intracranial hemorrhage. The outcomes were very slightly favoring the aggressive blood pressure approach with an absolute risk reduction of about 3 to 4%. But if you look at this, these are the modified Rankin scores presented in the lower right-hand corner of this slide. Really, the outcomes did not change very substantially. They certainly weren't worse. So I think that's a reason to continue to do this therapy. But the benefits probably are not the ones that really we are looking for. And certainly, these hemorrhages are smaller in size than the ones that typically present to surgical attention. Almost identical trial, also published in the New England Journal of Medicine in 2016, found no difference. This is 1,000 patients randomized to this trial, virtually identically done. Slight decrease in the amount of expansion, but the neurological outcome, the functional outcome was identical. So those are most of the medical therapies that are largely futile with managing this condition. Within the treatment guidelines, blood pressure control is really the only one outside of coagulopathy correction that has made it there. So larger hemorrhages are ones that we consider surgical treatment for. What are our tools? What's in our toolbox? What's in our toolbox is placing a catheter into the hematoma and giving alteplase to break down the hematoma and slowly evacuate it. We can put a camera into the hematoma and evacuate it with instruments that can go through ports within that camera. We could do a larger port and use conventional surgical techniques. Then there's a standard open surgery for evacuating a hematoma. Then there's also removing the bone, not touching the hematoma at all, but removing the bone and allowing the brain to relax and not cause a herniation event. And these are all tools within the toolbox of a neurosurgeon for managing this condition. So this is not a published classification of intracerebral hemorrhage sizes, but you know there are, especially when you start to think about these cases surgically, we tend to divide these into hemorrhages that are smaller or bigger, or ones that we think we should intervene on. So ones that are smaller as a subtype, you know, the quote-unquote leave well enough alone, small hemorrhage, it could be, we don't know to this date, but you know, it's you can see that this hemorrhage in itself, you can still see the lateral ventricle well. There may be some slight local mass effect on this, on the patient's deep nuclei, but it could stand to bear that this patient would do the best without touching this hematoma. Conversely, there are very large hemorrhages that involve the deep spaces that you can see how substantial the mass effect is from this very large right-sided hematoma. And this is patients that really, with the best care and the best of luck, will probably achieve a modified Rankin of 4 would be the most optimistic outcome for a hematoma of this size. It does depend on the patient's age and their pre-hemorrhage neurological function, but this is a very large hematoma that would very likely have a modified Rankin of 4 would be the most optimistic outcome. The hemorrhages that probably should be focused in the trials and that are being focused in the trials are these so-called Goldilocks hemorrhages, or the ones much like the childhood tail that are not very small or ones that would even be difficult to address surgically. They're not very large in that they've not done so significant damage that a good outcome is not achievable, but are kind of in the middle of the road. And maybe the patient will swell around this hematoma. Maybe they will require emergency surgery, et cetera. And these are ones that potentially an early surgical intervention should be offered. I certainly think they are the ones that should be randomized in trials, and you'll see the trial criteria here in a second. But I think these are the most ideal ones to address surgically. So looking at different types of evacuation, this is an open craniotomy of four, and this is not, this is I actually had this file years ago from the internet, it was on YouTube. I thought it was just a standard video on how to openly address a hematoma. So this is not me operating, and I actually cannot even find this video anymore, so I don't know who to credit with this operation. But I've used it for years, and I think it's a standard technique for how to take out a hematoma that I've kind of edited through. So what we're seeing here is we're seeing the leaflets around the brain have been reflected. The tissue right in the middle of the field is the patient's brain. They had a moderate sized hematoma. And this one likely presented very close to the surface, so the surgeon elected to just in an open fashion to remove the hematoma. And you can see they're using instruments here to take out the hematoma. It typically has this quote unquote current jelly or kind of a dark purple look. And you can slowly move around the edges of the cavity and remove this hematoma. And it's a pretty standard technique. Certainly, you can see the brain was very full during the early part of this video, and now it looks to be much more relaxed. So much of the pressure has been removed, and then this surgeon in particular is using a hemostatic agent after removing the hematoma to get control of that, that area. So that's just an open approach to surgery. And this is what was done in the STITCH trial. STITCH is an acronym, Surgical Treatment of Intracerebral Hemorrhage, STICH. This was a large trial sponsored out of the UK, but it was an international study. Over 1,000 patients were enrolled. About half of them were deep and half of them were superficial. They were the in-between size hemorrhages. About 40 milliliters was the average size of the hematoma in this trial. However, you can see on the right side, you can look at the unfavorable and favorable outcome between the early surgery versus the conservative surgery, and the outcomes were essentially identical. So really no improvement in outcome was seen in the STITCH trial. And this was I started residency in 2007. This was published in 2005. So really early off in my training, the dogma was intracerebral hemorrhage really isn't a surgical problem. And perhaps non-operative care for these patients is the best option, or at least as good as surgical care. What they did notice from the first STITCH trial was that hemorrhages that came to the surface perhaps did slightly better compared to the deep hemorrhages. So they decided to repeat the study and to only randomize patients who had very superficial hemorrhages, much like the one you see in the center of this slide. This was slightly smaller in size, but still a well-sized trial, especially by neurosurgical standards. There were 600 patients randomized to this. Again, these are middle-sized hemorrhages, and almost all of them were done open. 98% of the hemorrhages were taken out in an open fashion. The outcome, unfortunately, was about the same. You can see it did not reach statistical significance, maybe a 3-6% risk reduction and a poor outcome and improvement in survival, but this was not statistically significant, even though 600 patients were randomized to this study. Interestingly, patients who were deemed to be have a poor prognosis by this fancy equation you see in the top of the slide actually did have a statistically significant better chance of outcome versus the ones that were, in a preoperative sense, said to be a good prognosis. So patients with better neurological exams that are younger with small hemorrhages didn't really do much better. Conversely, patients with worse exams that were older with large hemorrhages did have a benefit. This is a post hoc analysis, so it should be interpreted with caution, but still an interesting finding from this trial. So what about minimally invasive removal? So the field basically gravitated after STITCH 2 and said, look, maybe doing open surgery where we're doing larger incisions in the brain, et cetera, maybe we're disrupting a lot of the white matter tracts you see. And perhaps there's so much iatrogenic injury that we're negating any benefit from taking out the hematoma. So the field has gone to what can we do in a less invasive or minimally invasive fashion to remove the hemorrhage and cause as little iatrogenic injury as possible. We're going to do a little bit of geometry here. These are cross-sectional pictures. The yellow circles are cross-sectional pictures of devices. used to remove hematomas. On the far left, you see a very small circle. This would be a standard ventricular drain that's placed into a hematoma where alteplase can be administered. That's about 2 or 3 millimeters in diameter. The sheath you see right next to it would be consistent with the sheath we would put a camera into for an endoscopic evacuation. Then the endoport evacuation would be these four circles and ellipses to the right, where you can see are much larger. Now, these are the diameters, the 2 millimeter, 6.3 millimeter, 11. These are the diameters of these devices. But I would submit that it's not the diameter that matters. What matters is the cross-sectional area, if we want to talk about iatrogenic injury. So if we remember from our early educational days, calculating pi times r squared to get the cross-sectional area, you see now that the size of these devices are dramatically different. They're not subtly different, where the square millimeters of an EVA catheter is only 3. As we go up to the endoscopic port, now it's 30 square millimeters. And as we go to the endoports, it's 100 and greater than 100 square millimeters. So I think there is a these are small devices. They are not very big, but I think it's fair to say that the catheter on the far left of the screen is dramatically smaller than some of the endoport devices, and we want to put that out there so we understand this. So what's a perfect device? What would be the ideal scenario? Well, number one, and there's very good evidence for this, you really want to get the whole hematoma out. You want complete ICH removal, or very close to complete ICH or intracerebral hemorrhage removal. You want it to be safe, so you don't want a recurrent hemorrhage. You got to be able to obtain hemostasis surgically. And lastly, you want to have as little morbidity as possible. That means you want to use the smallest device as possible. Also, second to these is cost. So you want the device to be as cheap as possible, and you also want it to be easy to learn and easy to use. You don't want a long learning curve where surgeons have to do 50 or 100 cases to have good outcomes from this. At least in the US, there's 100,000 of these occurring every year. You'd like something that all surgeons across the country can easily use and develop the skill set to treat these hematomas effectively. I'm just gonna look at the time real quick. So the catheter-based thrombolysis is the least invasive. So this is placing a small catheter into the hematoma and infusing alteplase. What are the pros about it? It is the least invasive, as I mentioned. It's also the best studied. So the MIST-C3 trial is the one that is recently published, and this has the best data for it. The cons are, or the downside to this strategy, is it's very slow removal of the hematoma. You only get the entire hematoma out about 60% of the time. The other time there's substantial residual, and it's very difficult for lobulated hemorrhages. It only really is ideal for spherical hemorrhages. So the endoport strategy is basically using different ports. So there's a few on the market. They are similar to the ones you see here in this picture. What are the pros of this? Well, the hemostasis is the best with this. Surgeons can use bimanual technique, which is what we do for any other type of surgery, including aneurysm or tumor surgery, a trauma surgery, etc. So it's very familiar to surgeons. And also you get the whole hematoma out immediately, in opposed to placing a catheter and slowly infusing alteplase over 2 or 3 days. The downside is it is the most invasive of the least invasive technology. So a little bit of an oxymoron, but it is the largest of the minimally invasive strategies. Endoscopic really balances both of these, I think, quite well. You get excellent visualization through the camera. It is less invasive than endoport, and you get complete removal of the hematoma immediately versus waiting a couple of days. The hemostasis ability, there is a learning curve there for surgeons to adapt to this technique. You can only use one instrument at a time or one hand at a time as you're addressing bleeding, and the cost is fairly substantial. The devices that have been developed required significant research and development, and they are costly. So I might just skip over this just for the sake of time. We can go through it very quickly. So if you have a standard hematoma in the brain and you put an endoport into that hematoma, really your vision is outside of that, and you're somewhat limited. And I'll have some case demonstrations so you can see this for yourself. Conversely, an endoscope is unique. You may think that the visualization is worse, but actually as you put the camera through the sheath, your point of vision is actually inside the hematoma, and you can use angled cameras to look around the hematoma cavity and actually get an excellent view of the hematoma cavity for the purpose of hemostasis. It does take slightly more time to do so, but with irrigation and patience, these can be done safely as well. And probably skip through this. This is an endoscopic case of a partner of mine, Dr. German Walla, and I only wanted to show it just because in the field of pituitary surgery, which is very different than intracerebral hemorrhage, you can see how doing these less invasive, actually they had better visualization. And this is a long video. I think just for the sake of time, we're going to go past it. So there are three trials that have been done, one completed and two ongoing, looking at minimally invasive strategies for addressing hematomas. So if we look at the criteria for these trials, they're really strikingly similar, as they should be. They're really randomizing patients that have good preoperative neurological function. They are not operating on patients on novel anticoagulant or direct oral anticoagulants. They are excluding renal failure due to platelet inhibition and issues with hemostasis. But you can see as you go through all these different criteria, they're virtually identical across all three trials. So they're very similar, and I think that's important because ultimately we're going to end up comparing these trials to one another. So if we look at that MISTI-3, which is the minimally invasive surgical treatment of ICH evacuation, that's the acronym MISTI, was 500 patients randomized, place a small catheter in, give alteplase. This was recently completed and published in 2019. So what did the results show us? A little bit disappointing, to be frank. So these are the modified Rankin scores. You can see they're almost identical from the best medical therapy compared to the minimally invasive evacuation. Almost identical. If I direct your attention towards the right, you'll see that the it was significant that there were more survivors in the MISTI trial versus the best medical therapy. So that's a big deal. It was the first trial to show that minimally invasive techniques can improve survival. So that is an accomplishment itself. But the overall outcomes were not quite as good. If we take a slightly deeper dive into the outcomes, this is looking at the amount of hematoma that was residual or extent of hematoma evacuation. On the left side, you see these are patients that have very little hematoma, and you can see their modified Rankin scores are dramatically better than those that had substantial hematoma left in the cavity. So also this has shown that getting the hematoma out is an important aspect to ICH evacuation. Dr. Awad, Assam Awad, who is one of the principal investigators in MISTI, published this deep analysis right after the trial was completed. And on the left side, you'll see that it is the extent of resection of the hematoma. We're on the left side of this graph. You see these are patients who had virtually all of their hematoma evacuated, and their probability of having a modified Rankin of 3 or better is dramatically better. You can see these numbers go up to almost 70%. 70% good outcome for patients that had their entire hematoma evacuated, and that's impressive, especially when the statistics tell us maybe 10 to 40% of these patients are going to have a functional outcome. The trial showed that if you get the entire hematoma out, it's almost 70%. So that's a big step in the right direction. Unfortunately, that was only accomplished in about 60% of the patients, but proof of concept, removing the hematoma, better neurological outcome. Similarly, this is just a relative value on the right side. As the percent of hematoma evacuated, as you get to the 80, 90, 100%, we'll kind of move along for the sake of time. I don't want to go over too much. So basically what MISTI demonstrated for us was that you need to get the entire hematoma out. Getting half of the hematoma out or 60% is not adequate. Really, you need to have less than 15 milliliters or greater than 70% evacuation. And ideally, you really need 90 to 100% evacuation to get a good outcome, or as neurosurgeons refer to it in tumor speak, a gross total resection of the hemorrhage. So these are the lessons, and I've kind of gone over these. It was the first trial to show that you can reduce mortality. It defined the treatment endpoints, and it also outlined some nuances of how to do this technique, catheter-based thrombolysis. The ENRICH trial is an industry-sponsored trial using tubes and a minimally invasive evacuation device you see in the lower right-hand corner. This is just a mechanical debrider that removes hematoma. It's a relatively large trial, 300 patients, and it should complete next summer, so we'll wait to see the results of that. Important to note, the principal investigators have told us that They are no longer randomizing patients with deep hemorrhages because they have concluded that they would lose any statistical power to show benefit. So this is just now randomizing superficial hemorrhages. MIND, which is minimally invasive neuroevacuation device, is a similarly designed study randomizing endoscopic removal versus best medical therapy. And we've got about 4 years until that trial will complete of 500 patients. So here's some case examples. This is a very classic patient that is managed surgically, a hypertensive middle size or Goldilocks hemorrhage, so to speak. She came in with a very high systolic blood pressure. Here's her initial head CT. You can see she has a hematoma on the left side that's about 40 milliliters in size. On hospital day number 2, you can see this is slightly expanded. You can see effacement of the lateral ventricle, and you also see there's more mass effect and shift. So this is a patient where she's heading down the wrong road. She's also neurologically slightly decompensated. So these are cases that I think very much benefit from surgical evacuation. And that's what we did. So here's the approach we did was behind her left ear. We used a device that you can see in the hand here with the stereotactic navigation. And basically this device is placed right into the hematoma. And the surgeon, me in this case, can use suction and other instruments to safely evacuate the hematoma through a small tube. You can also see later in this video how easy it is to and safe it is to obtain hemostasis in these cases. So here's the hematoma being evacuated. You can see small bleeding that was likely the source of her hemorrhage to begin with, and these are very, very easily controlled with bipolar forceps. So this is basically the way that hematomas are being evacuated in the enriched trial, which is an endoport evacuation of hematomas. So we obtain hemostasis. You can see now the left lateral ventricle is wide open, and much of the mass effect from that hematoma has been resolved in the postoperative period. You can also do the same approach from a frontal approach. So this individual had a hematoma, again, a hypertensive hemorrhage, almost identical in size to the previous case. He's starting to swell very early. You can see this patient is getting a lot more edema or swelling posterior to the hematoma. And these are patients that are good surgical candidates as well. We take a frontal approach to this, and again, you can get most of the hematoma out. So you can go from the back of the head or from the front. Essentially, you take the shortest trajectory to go in the long axis of the hematoma. You can combine techniques, so you can use an even smaller tube and place a camera inside the tube. So this is what we've done. This is a combined endoport endoscopic evacuation of a hematoma. It allows surgeons to use bimanual technique to remove the hematoma and through a smaller port compared to the larger ports we used prior. Here's candidates that I do not think are good cases for evacuation of any type are ones that either have lobulated or petechial looking hemorrhages, that they do not come out as well as patients who have solid hematomas. This is a case example of such an example. So we did take this patient for a minimally invasive evacuation, and you can see really much of his mass effect is still there, and you do not get as good of a hematoma. This case would have been better served and was better served with just a standard craniectomy. You can see after the craniectomy, you can see the bone is removed from on the right side of your screen, the right half of his scalp. The bone has been evacuated. You can see much of the mass effect is relieved after removing the bone. So I think cases that have lobulated hemorrhages or petechial hemorrhages are better served with craniectomies rather than any type of evacuation technique. The criteria I laid out, I think all the minimally invasive techniques, I don't endorse any of them in particular. I think they should be used selectively, but I think they all meet the criteria. They're all effective, they're safe, and they have low morbidity. And the trials will tell us which one is better and perhaps which cases they are better for. And as a vote of to keep our spirits up, even though the trials haven't shown the best outcomes, I would like to remind us that an NINDS trial in 1995 giving TPA for stroke, that was a landmark study where we had better outcomes from giving TPA. Then there were many, everyone said, well, why don't we just take out those clots from ischemic strokes? Won't patients do better? And this is basically every randomized study and every prospective study done since then trying to show efficacy, and they were all neutral studies. It wasn't until just 5 years ago now, in 2015, that finally we figured it out and we found the answer, and now mechanical thrombectomy for ischemic stroke is the standard thing. And what happened? What changed? Well, we got the tools we needed. We had catheters to aspirate these clots. We have stents that can take these clots out. And then we have new imaging modalities that show us which patients are going to benefit from it. So similarly, for hemorrhages, we now have endoscopic instruments. We have endoports, et cetera. We now have the tools at our hands to do this type of intervention. So I'm optimistic that we'll show better outcomes with intracerebral hemorrhage. I think a mistake is that people look for a magic bullet. What is the one surgery or the one treatment that's going to really solve all this? And I really think it should be a multimodality treatment for evacuating hemorrhages. And if you'll remember this slide towards the beginning of the presentation, these hematomas are not all the same. They look different, different sizes, different shapes, et cetera. And I think our tools should be applied in that manner. So if we look at what tools we have, you know, endoport, catheter thrombolysis, et cetera, if you take this hematoma, for example, it's very large. Would this be served with a catheter thrombolysis? It's a pretty large hematoma. I'm not sure it'd be that effective. You know, when I look at this, the only thing I would probably stay away from is doing an open evacuation. You could use a scope. You could use an endoport. You could just do a craniectomy and give this patient more room. I think they're all probably good options for this case. I would probably personally do an endoport as my own comfort level and what I do, a standard surgical approach in my practice today. The only thing I would really avoid is an open craniotomy for this type of hemorrhage. Moving on to a different case, you see a lobulated hemorrhage here. It's multi-compartmental. I think any technique to try to take out this hemorrhage, it's also in an eloquent portion of the brain, is probably not an ideal circumstance. My preference would be to just do a craniectomy for this type of hemorrhage and to avoid evacuating the hemorrhage at all. Similarly, we go to this hemorrhage, it's pretty small. I think you could argue to just leave it alone. If you were gonna take it out, I think you'd wanna use as least invasive an option as possible. Maybe you place a catheter or an endoscope. The larger, the endoport or an open evacuation, I would certainly avoid in this case. I don't think a craniectomy would be appropriate either. You could certainly leave this hemorrhage alone, and we can just go through case by case. You know, I think different hemorrhages, as long as the surgeon has many tools in their toolbox, they can look at each case and really individualize how to take out the hematoma in the best way possible. I don't think it's going to be a magic bullet. I think it's going to be a multimodality treatment strategy. Other thoughts that I did not address, some people advocate for ultra early evacuation of hemorrhage. That is not anything that's being done in trials, but I said earlier that the primary hemorrhage is something we cannot fix. There are surgeons who advocate for very early intervention, treating these cases like an emergency where you decrease the expansion of the hemorrhage, and that can reduce primary injury. So that's something that is done in practice, not done in trials. Also, I have not touched on the management of intraventricular hemorrhage, which is a separate issue in itself. So next steps, MISTI-4 is the next trial enrolled. This is a trial where any center can enroll with whatever minimally invasive technique they would like. A surgeon has to do 10 cases. They can pick their technique and enroll in that, and that will start prior to coronavirus. It was going to start in February of 2021. It may be delayed. I'm not sure if it's going to start on time. We will also wait the results of the MIND and the ENRICH trial. So I will conclude. ICH is a very morbid condition. I think that's very clear. I think the medical therapy is largely futile. Minimally invasive techniques have decreased mortality. Lesions with mass effect can benefit from surgery. I think a multimodality approach is the way to do it, in my opinion. I think a pragmatic trial applying these therapies is the way that we should move forward. I think MISTI-4 is probably that pragmatic trial, and I think we should keep randomizing until we figure it out. I think it's right around the corner. These are just some mentors of mine that have, much of this work is their work, and I'm just organizing it and presenting it to you. I want to give them credit. These are people who have been part of my professional career, Dr. Zuccarello, Osama Wad, who's a local Chicago neurosurgeon, and Dr. Mendelow in the UK, was instrumental in the STITS trials, and I think they deserve acknowledgement. It's been a great honor being here at the AAPI. Thank you for the invitation. I'm very honored to receive it, and it's been a pleasure talking to everyone. Thanks again.
Thank you, Joe, for your...
Yeah. So thank you, Dr. Serrone, for a great talk. We have some questions from the audience and in our virtual audience, and lots of excellent comments appreciating the quality of the talk, so thank you for your time. The first question we have is, can evacuation be carried out in cases of brainstem hematoma?
Generally, the only cases with brainstem hematoma that benefit from evacuation. In the early part of the slide, we separated hematoma types, and really the structural ones, the ones that are due to cavernous malformations, are the ones that actually do very well with brainstem hemorrhages. Primary brainstem hemorrhages from either anticoagulants or hypertension do not do well from surgical management. Or any management for that matter. They do the worst of all the locations in the brain. The only exception to that are from cavernous malformations, who actually do quite well. Despite their imaging looking quite devastating, the patients will often come into the hospital talking because those hemorrhages have been there for a long time, slowly expanding. So that would be the only exception. It's an excellent question. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is, in hypertensive hemorrhages, how would you manage blood pressure? And what range of BP would you keep?
Yeah. So I think, you know, the trials took patients down to a systolic blood pressure of less than 140. I think I would stick to that. That's got the strongest evidence. These are two large randomized trials published in the New England Journal of Medicine. So I think systolic blood pressure goal of less than 140 would be a guideline-based and evidence-based approach to blood pressure management in the acute phase.
And do you routinely use seizure prophylaxis?
No. We do not routinely use seizure prophylaxis for these patients. There's some data that suggests Keppra in particular portends a worse outcome when given prophylactically. That was a retrospective analysis of that, so it's not anything that's been studied in a prospective fashion. It probably warrants prospective data. We do not routinely give antiepileptics, especially for deep hemorrhages. Cortical hemorrhages, it can be considered, but I think you would be in the scope of an evidence-based practice to give it or not. We tend to not give antiepileptics in patients who have not had a seizure.
Thank you. And the last question is, after stroke, how early or late can procedures be done with the breast prognosis?
I'm not sure I understand the question. Okay, how? Oh, I understand. So for the, as it pertains to intracerebral hemorrhage, the best outcomes can be attained before a neurological decline. So what we will often see is patients will have hemorrhages, they can have a decrease in their neurological status, and that's really when they're at risk for a lot of problems, aspiration pneumonia, urgent surgeries in the middle of the night, etc. Our practice is to follow these patients clinically, to follow them radiographically, and if we see evidence of mass effect, much like we saw in the case examples, we tend to do them earlier rather than later. And I think that's the best approach to avoid a lot of the problems, namely with airway problems and aspiration pneumonia, is to get ahead of it quicker surgically rather than later. And typically that's within the first 48 hours.
Thank you very much. That was all the questions.
Sure. Thanks again. Thank you.